On October 7th, 2001, the United States went to war in Afghanistan. U.S. and coalition forces toppled the Taliban in months, went about the business of pushing Afghanistan toward a new form of government, and then watched frustrated as the U.S. victory over the Taliban faded and the country once again became a battlefield priority for the United States. We're talking about Afghanistan's influence on New Mexico this week on the line, and we are joined by Paul Gessing, president of the Rio Grande Foundation. He's been with us before. We're glad to have him back. Here again, former House Republican Whip Dan Foley, always good to have him. Social media consultant Sophie Martin and environmental attorney Laura Sanchez. So, Sophie, 10 years on, as the Brits like to say, here we are. Some unfortunate factoids. We've had our highest number of casualties, U.S. troops in the war in August. Mm-hmm. We lost 70 soldiers. We've got untold billions going into this war. Your sense of where this is now, 10 years on, specifically for New Mexico, are we in lockstep, in your view, with how others are seeing this? Are we different somehow? Folks want this thing over, some don't. Where do you think we fit in?
I think one of the things that may be different for New Mexico as opposed to other states is that because we are such a small state population-wise, mm-hmm. I think that every fatality of a New Mexican in that war really hits us hard, mm-hmm. which is not to say that other communities don't feel it, but we are such a small community, mm-hmm. that it has become so difficult for people to say, either in the Iraqi conflict or in the Afghanistan conflict, that we don't know of someone or know of someone who right. who lost a family member. Mm-hmm. And I think that maybe adds an extra poignancy at this 10-year mark.
Mm-hmm. Paul, it's amazing to think about this. You know, for years we were hung up on, not hung up negatively, but on Vietnam. That was our last big, you know, sort of emotional hit here. But 10 years, it's an amazing situation. On the finances alone, what's your sense of where Americans are at, and Mexicans certainly, on what we're spending for this war and why we need to maybe perhaps change that outlook a little bit?
Well, certainly the spending's gone on for 10 years. It's mounting. The costs are piling up. And America, our budget situation clearly is not where it was 10 years ago. So I think people are ready to move on. People are concerned that we don't have a specific agenda moving forward. I think they're also seeing the success of some of these targeted actions with drone strikes and that kind of thing. Whether you agree with them or not, the effectiveness of going right after the people in question, as opposed to taking over a country that's been the graveyard of empires throughout history, mm-hmm. trying to promote democracy, implant a Western-style system in there, it's just, I think, dubious in most people's minds that we can get this kind of thing done. And I think most people in America and New Mexico support some kind of pulling back of that effort, minimal troops on the ground and more targeted strikes against the actual people trying to kill Americans.
Do you support that idea of leaving some troops on the ground there?
It's tough to get all troops out. Once troops go in, I mean, we've seen sure. Germany, we've seen Japan, North Korea, troops, once they go in, very rarely come out in the same numbers. So mm-hmm. I think the smallest number we can leave in, the better. Mm-hmm. But whether we get them all out, that's something that CIA and the president will have to work out.
Sure. Daniel, same question. Do we need a presence? Do we need to stay? If so, how long? How big? Do you have a thought on that?
Well, I feel like we don't have to stay.
Okay.
I feel like it's time to get out. I feel like it's time to move on. And I feel like that, you know, kind of along the lines of what Paul said, you know, these swift, direct actions, if we'll just keep the stomach for it and mm-hmm. say, when we have a problem, go take care of that problem and go home. I think we've done the best we can. You know, we've shown the folks in Afghanistan there's other ways of life. Mm-hmm. Maybe ours isn't the right one for them, but we've shown them. You know, we know that there's women going to school. We know there's elections being done. There's things happening in these countries that have never happened before. But I'm not sure it's just our place to go in and say, well, you should be just like us. And I think we've taken care of the problem that we said existed. You know, we continue to have to fight that battle. But I think that battle can be fought offshore. I think that battle can be fought from other bases. That battle can be fought from other strategic positions in the world mm-hmm. where we go in and take care of our problem and we get out. You know, we saw the way that they went and they took care of Osama bin Laden. You know, they went in, they got him, they got out. The way they did the strategic bombing of the Sheikh that they just mm-hmm. got. We did it. You know, we can do this stuff. The question is, do we have the stomach as a country to fathom turning on the TV, seeing that we've bombed something, we've killed these people. I think the country's getting that stomach. I think they're tired of turning the TV on and seeing our guys dying. Mm-hmm. I think it's time they say, you know, if we're going to do something, go do it with as minimal damage to us as possible.
Sure.
And I think that's got to be the philosophy as we move forward.
Sure. For Laura, both of you and Dan have connections to the southern part of the state by upbringing and all that kind of thing. And we've had a long history of military involvement for families here in New Mexico. Prideful, you know, history as a matter of fact. And speaking of Vietnam, it reminds me of back when reading about, you know, it was when Republican representatives went to Richard Nixon and said, and these are folks who were inclined to support the effort, said, look, I'm getting killed out here. Families are seeing no value in losing sons and daughters, or at that time just sons, to a war. You know, how do we get this across to policymakers that for folks, some folks, enough is enough, no matter where you're coming from on this kind of thing?
Well, I think we may be reaching a tipping point now, given all the circumstances, the enormous amount of deaths that we've seen in Afghanistan and in Iraq, and also just the way our economy is and, mm-hmm. and where our place is in the country compared to where we were 10 years ago. I mean, I agree with Dan, I'm not sure it's our place to continue this effort. You know, we went in for a very specific reason. We've accomplished the task of getting rid of public enemy number one. There's been the recent Awlaki shooting, excuse me. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think you have to at some point draw the line and figure out, okay, when is it time to really retreat? Mm-hmm. But I do think that Paul brings up a good point. A lot of it is about, a plan, an effective plan for withdrawal, mm-hmm. one that isn't immediate. I mean, there's a lot that at stake, and you can't really cede an entire situation immediately. But I think we need to see real action, and I think most people in this country are ready to see that, especially given the state of our economy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Alawaki, you brought that up. I do want to touch on that. Pretty good controversy rolling here. Fella born in New Mexico, mm-hmm. went to Al-Qaeda for whatever reason we don't know, considered a enemy combatant or belligerent in military terms. However, Fifth Amendment due process issues are at play here. What's your take on of the killing of an American-born person overseas? Are you satisfied that it met a threshold of an enemy combatant and therefore the idea of due process just shouldn't even get on the table?
No, I'm conflicted on this one. This mm-hmm. one isn't a clear cut for me, particularly because he was American-born. Mm-hmm. So he did have the same rights that you and I enjoy as being American citizens. I don't know what the status was of his own claiming of those rights. I'm not sure if he may have, you know, abandoned basically his citizenship. Mm-hmm. And if so, I think that places him in a different legal situation in terms of enforcing those rights, mm-hmm. or it could. I think what's troubling to me is that there was apparently some reports of a justice memo that had surfaced, mm-hmm. and that there was more of an order to kill a particular person, to kill him under certain circumstances, which were followed through. And I think when you start to see memos that are surfaced from on high, and there are people making decisions without taking into consideration that the person may have had some rights as a U.S. citizen, I think it really crosses a line in terms of what we're supposed to have as basic rights in this country. So I'm mixed on the issue. On the mm-hmm. one hand, he obviously was dangerous. I think he had, you know, it was very clear that he had posed a threat to the U.S. Mm-hmm. What's puzzling to me, and I think frightening for a lot of people, is that he was from our own home state, from Las Cruces, and that makes it difficult for us on mm-hmm. a personal level. But it is, I think, for me, a difficult situation and not clear as far as it you know, a clear-cut case of an enemy combatant.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, I do. Frankly, I'm deeply conflicted about mm-hmm. it, because certainly our rights as citizens are ones we all cherish and we all have a stake in maintaining. Mm-hmm.
Are you afraid of a precedent, perhaps?
I think that's something that we always have to worry about, that this is the foot in the door. I don't think that we're going to see widespread use of this strategy against U.S. citizens, mm-hmm. but it is still worrisome.
Absolutely. Now, in a moment, farm subsidies. New Mexico gets millions of dollars in agricultural help, but is it going to the right places? And should taxpayer subsidies be there at all?
we're going to set up a camp, we're going to let the world know that we're angry, doesn't trump everybody else's rights. And that's something these people don't understand. You know, we got in our list here about talking about the guy that was arrested. You know, it's funny, we march down the street and we go into businesses yelling at business owners and spitting on people. I mean, this is absurd. This is absolutely crazy.